Hey, good morning. You want to hear a dad joke? What do you call a fish without an eye?
Psh. All right, so two guys walk into a bar, and the third one ducked.
So why should you hold up a one iron in the thunderstorm? Because not even God can hit a one iron.
Hey, kids, I got you Fortnite, but it'll only last 2 weeks.
What do you call a sad strawberry? A blueberry.
Hey, what time of day did God create Adam? A little before Eve. Get it? You know, Eve, evening.
Where do you go to learn how to make a banana split? Sunday school.
How do you teach your children about taxes? Eat 38% of their ice cream.
Why do people say amen instead of a woman at the end of a song in a church? Because they sing hymns, not hers.
Okay, go ahead. You know, I just love the one about the little 4-year-old girl, and she's being interviewed by this man who asks her the question, how old do you think your dad is? And she looks at him and says, well, my dad's exactly the same age as me. And the man just is incredulous, and he says, how in the world can that be so? And she says, well, my dad always tells me that he didn't become a dad until the day I was born.
I don't trust those trees over there. They seem kind of shady.
Went to the doctor the other day, and I told him, doctor, I keep having these dreams. One night I'm a teepee, the next night I'm a wigwam, then a teepee, then a wigwam, and it just every other night it just kept going and going. And said, Brandy, you need to relax. You're just too tense.
What woman of the Bible had the most financial wisdom? Pharaoh's daughter. She went down to the bank of the Nile and took out a little profit.
To you from the wilderness. And I'm going to tell you, I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for my friends this week at Vacation Bible School. We learned that God is surprising. Awesome God. Check out the friends I met this week.
God's love now.
Yeah.
Good morning. Well, as you could tell from that video, we had a lot of fun in VBS. I'd like to take a couple minutes to thank our amazing volunteers from this week. Thank you to our crew leaders, our crew aides, our kitchen team, our check-in helpers, our VBS aides, audiovisual team, pastoral staff, setup and teardown crew, and anybody who donated supplies or prayed for our children and VBS team this week. Without all of you, this week would not have been possible. I want to give a great big thanks to our planning team. They're the ones you see in the orange shirts. They worked tirelessly throughout the entire year to get this one week ready. And so thank you guys, you did an amazing job. This year there will be a little change in leadership. Sarah Abels has been our director for many years, and she is passing the torch to Cindy Wojcik, who will be our director in the future. We're very excited to see what Cindy brings to us. I'm sure it's going to be out of this world. We're doing space next year. I'm going to pass the microphone over to Carolyn, who's going to get us started.
Hey, everybody. Well, I just have to say, I'm going to scooch right up here. We had an absolutely monumental week last week, and I am so excited to see all of these volunteers and kids back to share a little bit with you. You saw a few minutes of our video that was our wrap-up video of fun things that we did all week long. We had 125 kids registered. We had 80 volunteers, and I just want to give praise for that. It's really amazing. So during the week, we learned some very important things. Everybody ready? We learned that God loves you no matter what.
Awesome God!
We learned that God is with you everywhere.
Awesome God!
We learned that God is in charge.
Awesome God!
We learned that God is stronger than anything.
Awesome God!
And most of all, we learned that God is surprising.
Awesome God!
And now we'd like to sing for you.
God's love never fails and it lasts forever. Our God is great. Our God is great. My God is with me. Yes, he's with me. Bigger than my wildest dreams.
live right now. That's down at Kirk Hall, so we brought the whole congregation together for that. But yeah, over 100 volunteers and almost 200 kids. It was quite a week. Thank you for your prayers. Let's stand together and worship together. I did want to remind you, we have a congregational meeting following this service. We'll go down to Kirk Hall, brief meeting to see the budget, to elect officers. So don't let me walk down the center aisle or something and forget that, all right? We're going that way afterwards. But let's stand together. I've asked Levi Murphy to come and lead us in our call to worship this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Come bless the Lord with me, for the Lord is like a father to his children.
Compassionate and merciful.
Filled with endless love.
He forgives our sins.
And heals the sickness inside us.
He surrounds us with love and mercy.
And fills our lives with good things.
Let's worship God together.
Praise God.
This is my Father's love, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's love, I rest me in the cause of rocks and
Jesus the Christ. Amen. Please be seated. Let us now humbly bow before God, acknowledging this call to confession as written in the Book of Psalms. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. We pray together, first of all in unison, and then pause for a few moments in silence for our own personal prayers of confession. Come now, join with me as we pray. Dear Lord, you are the King of the world, the Creator of all things, and the Giver of life. You have made us in your image and invited us to be your children, the heirs of your kingdom. And we give you our thanks and praise. We confess that we have sinned and fallen short of what you would have us be. We have found our identity in earthly things like work, money, family, reputation, our homes, our friends, even our country. We have worshiped them more than you. We have turned away from being part of your kingdom work to satisfy our own agendas. We have broken your heart with our sin, and we are sorry. Please forgive us. Help us open our hearts to receive the gift of forgiveness that you offer through Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. Create in us clean hearts and fill us with your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Gracious God, you have heard our prayers, and now may we experience your forgiveness, also as written in the book of Psalms. Bless our Father God, the God of all salvation, who daily bears us up and rescues us from the sin and death. Our God is a God who saves. Truly, this is an affirmation of God's grace.
Indeed, happy Father's Day. What a great start we had to our worship. Those wonderful jokes, right? Dad? God bless our fathers, particularly today. I've been in a mind thinking of my dad as well and all the stories. And, you know, dads for sons are really a picture, or should be a picture oftentimes, of what it means to be a man. And certainly a lot of the good things that I think I picked up and some of the not so good things are because I was watching my dad. And my dad was, like many of your dads, he was a guy who just seemed to be able to do everything and anything. He was a Navy pilot, flew off of aircraft carriers, college professor. I remember when he left the family for about 2 months, 3 months, moved ahead of us from where he'd done his master's to Lansing, Michigan to finish his PhD. It was always, it seemed, the family, and then dad sometimes was the Lone Ranger just pulling us along. One of the times I think I've shared with you that we really saw that is when we went camping once in Europe. Our family camped a lot because dad is a college professor. We had the summers off. And we actually went and camped for 11 straight weeks in a tent in Europe. And one of the things mom and dad had done is gotten everybody a windbreaker. The kids had yellow windbreakers, so if we got lost in a crowd, they could pick us out. Mom had a red windbreaker, and dad had a blue windbreaker. And it was a great trip, 9 countries. Right up to the time that we got to the airport to fly home, and for some reason we got up to the counter, and then all of a sudden my mom was ushering me and the other kids outside while dad stayed in to do some negotiation. We were wondering what happened. He was gone for like half an hour, 45 minutes. Finally, mom shared with us that turned out the travel agent who'd made our travel arrangements had purchased one-way tickets to Europe rather than round-trip tickets to Europe. And the three kids, I think I was 12, and my brother was, sister was 14, and my brother 16, actually 10, 12, and 14, started to get worried, and my mom said, "Kids, there's nothing to worry about." And we said, "How are we going to get home?" And she said, "Our fearless blue leader will take care of it." And so I had this picture of manhood as being the one who independently could change the airlines, you know, do anything he wanted. He could take care of anything. And that's kind of the picture oftentimes that we have of manhood. And that's a good thing in some ways, but it's not such a good thing in others. You know that song that Sinatra sings, "I'll do it my way." You know, you're supposed to be a man. You can handle life on your own. And yet the reality is, the older we grow, we realize that's really not the way that we're made, is it? I remember doing a funeral for a young man. A family I didn't know. I was called out of the blue by a funeral home saying, "We need a pastor." I showed up. The young man had died of a drug overdose at 23 years old, such a tragic loss of life. And because the funeral director had arranged the whole service, all I knew is when I was supposed to get up and speak or get up and pray. I didn't know anything else about the service. They ended the service with a song, by this very song by Frank Sinatra. And I just was struck by the sad irony of a life lived with that idea of doing it my way. And now the end is here, and so I face that final curtain. My friend, I'll make it clear, I'll state my case of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway, and more, much more, I did it my way. What a heartbreak. And it ends with this machismo statement. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not. To say the things that he truly feels and not the words of one who kneels. No, a good man never kneels, right? The record shows I took my blows and did it my way. But that's not Christ's way, is it? Let's test this picture of masculinity by Scripture. Now, you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. Very different picture, isn't it? This lone independent that can take the world on his shoulders versus one who says, I'm actually dependent on every other part of the body of Christ. In fact, the larger passage just comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let me just read it for you. It gives this picture, and I'm going to come back to it, even though it's not our primary text. But here's Paul beginning in verse 14 of 1 Corinthians 12. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. Now, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being a part of the body. As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. So last week was the second week in this mini-series that we have on what are the habits that we have to build into our lives to mature in Christ. If you feel like, you know, you haven't grown much, you haven't become much more like Jesus, you're not really feeling connected to the divine power that made us all, my guess is that the three habits that we've talked about, two that we've talked about and one we'll talk about today, have not been a disciplined part of your life as much as the habits that have caused you to grow physically, like eating and sleeping and having water to drink and exercise and those things. In the same way, we don't grow spiritually without some habits. And so 2 weeks ago, we introduced the foundational habit. We don't grow spiritually if we're not seeking God, not just on Sunday mornings, but daily. And so I suggested to you having a daily time with God in His Word and with prayer. The second habit we looked at next week, I called the antidote to materialism. We are in a culture where our main idol, our main God, is stuff. It's money. We think if we have enough money in the bank, we'll be okay for the future, rather than trusting in the one who gave us that money in the first place. And so the second habit, after daily time seeking God, is weekly or regularly giving from our resources to God. And again, if you don't do that, if you're not sacrificially giving, no surprise, you're not going to grow spiritually. You'll continue to be in fear of your future because of your finances. Well, today we're going to talk about this idea of body, really of being a part of a smaller group of people. It's what the Bible calls fellowship. Fellowship. So fellowship is the antidote to this idea of individualism in the same way that giving is the antidote to materialism. So what is maturity? What's its goal? Well, think about what we do in life, okay? So we start out in life, and we are utterly dependent, right? A little baby infant, and we need, that child right there needs mom and dad to do absolutely everything. Isn't that a great picture? I love that one. And yet we hope that that child doesn't remain dependent its entire life, don't we? And so we go through life, and we try to teach that child thing. In fact, a lot of good parenting, fathering and mothering, is trying to instruct kids in things. And eventually, we hope, of course, that they're going to graduate from something. They're about to leave the nest. Can I share the good news with you? My youngest child, Evan, so he's the youngest of my twins, actually left Friday for his, as he calls it, his big boy job, his first job after college, where he's going to go up and work in logistics for a company outside of Chicago. And so this is a good moment. Now, Evan is no longer dependent. Evan's going to call sometime in the next 6 weeks and say, hey, I need a little. And I'm like, no, you already got a lot. You're on your own, buddy, right? You can do this. You're getting a paycheck, you know? And so that's the hope, right, that we grow beyond that. And along the way, of course, we're teaching things. We're modeling things. We're doing all sorts of things. But we hope, my hope for Evan and for Connor and for McKenna isn't that they've moved from complete dependence to independence, because that's not to be human. I hope that they grow in the future into interdependence, that they find their place in the community. Yes, the community of God's people, but also the community just of faces and people. That they realize that there's young and old, there's black and white, and they have a part to play in that, and they are dependent on those people, and those people are dependent on them. The highest form of development is interdependency, and the same is true for us. Oftentimes, particularly in American Christianity, we treat Christianity as if Jesus came simply to give us our own personal get-out-of-jail-free card, get to heaven. It's our insurance plan. But the case is that Christ actually came to make a new people, to bind us together, to bring us into an intimate fellowship, and it's that fellowship that I want to talk about briefly today. We get a picture of it, actually, a beautiful picture, in Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. Let me read it aloud for you. This, again, is the picture right after Pentecost, and after Peter's sermon. This is the description of the early church, and it should be the description of us. And I've capitalized some words, and I want you to notice the theme that they have among them. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together, and they had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. You see all those capitalized words? What do they all have in common? What's the theme of this passage? Yes, it's about what the church does, its purposes, but what holds it all together? It's this community, isn't it? In fact, you see something interesting. I've called this passage, this message, incidentally, doing life together. That's the essential habit we're talking about. If you're going to grow in maturity, you've got to find a smaller group of people to do life together with. And the remarkable thing that we get of this picture of the early church is if you go one verse before, here's what it says. Maybe I didn't give them this one upstairs. Let me read it for you. Those who accepted Peter's message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. And so we have 3,000 plus believers, and then it says they did all these things together that we're going to review in a moment. And what you'll see is there's no way those things can happen with 3,000 people at a time. You can't break bread, for instance, in each other's homes 3,000 at a time. How many people fit in your home? You know? And so the assumption, what it's intimating is that somehow this group of 3,000 got into relationship with each other in order to do the things the church is supposed to do. It wasn't just the apostles and 3,000 at a time. Now, you can do church, mega church. In fact, I looked up a picture, almost put it in the slide, of one of the largest churches in the nation, Joel Osteen's Lakewood Church. He meets in the Houston Metrodome. But I'm pretty sure what's going on there is not the picture that we just got in Acts chapter 2:42. They do some of it. But that church and every church is going to have smaller groups if somehow they're going to have their people grow into maturity. In fact, here's a question for you. If you were not at worship today, if you didn't come here today, would there be any evidence throughout the rest of the week that you actually were a part of the body of Christ? I'm sure there'd be evidence that you're a Christ follower by the way you speak to people, by the things that you do, how you spend your money, things like that. But do we give any evidence other than coming together in corporate worship that we're part of what's called the body of Christ, a smaller group of believers? And for many of us, the answer is no. We're not doing a Bible study with anybody. We didn't volunteer for vacation Bible school with that ministry. We're not working in the food pantry. And yet it's essential if we're going to mature in Jesus Christ that we somehow find a way to do life together. God's design, Christ's way, not my way, is relationships. The parts of the body working together, doing life together. And so let's do a quick exercise here. We're going to go back to Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47, and we're going to break it down, and these are the five purposes of the Church of Jesus Christ. And we've actually adopted these as the five purposes of Central College. If you got your little note sheet there, I'm going to give them to you. You can fill in the blanks as we go. So it begins with verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. That's what at Central College we call discipleship. And so part of our purpose is to make disciples, right? To help people become followers of Jesus Christ. Now I want you to think for just a moment about your own life. And I'm guessing you becoming a disciple had less to do with who stood up here on a Sunday morning and preached a 20-minute message, and it had to do with somebody else in your life, somebody you were in relationship with. Do you have somebody in mind who modeled being a Christ follower, or who made sure you got to church, or gave a special timely word when you were in Sunday school or some other time in life? Raise your hand if you got somebody in mind. All right, would you turn to the person next to you? I'm going to give you 30 seconds. Tell them who that is. Who helped you become a disciple of Jesus Christ? Just give them a name. You can give them a little background if you want. Give kudos where kudos are due. So the point is, when I asked that question, you immediately had at least one or more people come to mind. And it wasn't 3,000 people. It was somebody that you were doing life together with, somebody who had permission to speak into your life because they were a relative, maybe a grandmother or a grandfather or a parent or a friend. You know, for me, it was, I would have brought up Monty Clareman. Remember Monty? He came and worshiped and led with us for a while. Monty is the one who in 10th grade, invited me to a Bible study, a small group Bible study, and that's where I heard about Jesus. I'd been going to church, but I was in a very, very liberal Presbyterian church, and we didn't talk a whole lot about the guy. You know, we talked about being good people. But there I was because of a relationship. Monty said, would you come to my Bible study? And there I was with about 20 kids, and I heard about Jesus. So discipleship happens best in these smaller communities. Our text goes on. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. And so the second purpose of the church at Central College, and I say the church everywhere, is this idea of fellowship. And what it's not talking about is Ballard Hall. It's not talking about going to a place to get a cup of coffee. It's talking about this deep life on life together, because it's in these smaller groupings that we learn how to be human. So think about your own family. I find this very amusing when people get married. So one of the spouses comes from this learning laboratory called a family, and this other spouse comes from a different learning laboratory called a family. And guess what? These two families didn't do the same things. They didn't fight the same way. They didn't do Christmas morning the same way. And so all of a sudden you have to come into a new fellowship, a new family, and iron sharpens iron, right? You try to pick up the good from each and put away the bad of each, and all of a sudden you've got your new family unit. Well, the same is true in the church. That true fellowship is going to happen, not again, when we come together. I think there's about 140 of us here in this service today about that. We can't do true fellowship with 140 people. You've got to break it down. Jesus himself broke it down a little bit. He did fellowship with a much smaller group. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, and then it says to the breaking of bread and to prayer. What do you think that's talking about? What's the breaking of bread and prayer? It's worship, isn't it? It's what we do in here. So it's probably referring to communion. And certainly you can do worship with 3,000 or with 10,000, but I'm guessing worship is more powerful to you when you're sitting next to somebody that you know. Anybody sit in the same pew pretty much more or less every Sunday? Yeah, yeah. Incidentally, we do reserve pews at Central College. So if you see somebody sitting in your pew, you tell them it's your pew. They cost $10,000 a Sunday to reserve your pew. No, so why do we sit in the same pew every Sunday? Because of the relationship. Because you're sitting next to somebody who knows a bit of your story. They've probably prayed for you. When you got that cancer diagnosis, this was somebody, one of the few people you were willing to tell about that, right? And so even in worship, there's something that happens where it's not just 140 individuals worshiping, but you're worshiping with family. You're worshiping with people that you have relationships with. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayer. It goes on in verse 43, they sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And so we call that service. That's the fourth purpose of the church, is service or ministry. And yes, this is something that we can do as a whole church, and we do. And so when there's a war that breaks out in Ukraine, you give money to the church, and we do service. We give that money to them. But I know that there the actual service takes place, and I never hear about it, because it's when you see your neighbor who's struggling to get their lawn cut, and you go over and help them. Or when you know that there's a widow living alone, and the power goes out. Anybody have your power go out? Wasn't that a joyous 2 days for some? And you are the one who goes and knocks on the door and says, are you okay? Or when they need their walk shoveled. Because God has designed us not to meet the needs of the whole world. In fact, part of the problem in our culture, in our contemporary world, is we get all of this news about tragedies everywhere, you know, school shootings and famine here, and we can't do anything about it. But we're hardwired. We're made to be in community. And so the place we're really supposed to take care of people is when God puts somebody in front of us. And so you see somebody in need holding a sign up that says, hungry, need work, don't call the church and say, Pastor, can you give that guy a job? If they're in front of you, God's probably saying, maybe that's somebody you should connect with. So again, service happens best in relationship. In fact, I'd say the best ministry happens with groups of people, with small groups. How many of you work in the food pantry? So right here is a small army, and you guys know each other. You rub shoulders with each other and decide how the ministry works. That's the way it's supposed to happen. Not by the big church making all the decisions, but by those doing the ministry making the decisions. And when we do those four purposes, discipleship, fellowship, worship, and service, then God does his part, and that's called evangelism. Yeah, he uses us, but look at verse 47. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. God says, you work in the way that I've designed you to work in these groupings of people relationally, and guess what? I'm naturally going to spill over into other people's lives. In fact, a whole bunch of this book that we call the Bible, particularly the New Testament, has one phrase over and over. It's the phrase, one another. 43 different ways it says that you and I should do this with one another. Let me give you just a few of them. You can jot these down if you want. Here's Romans 16:16. Greet one another with a holy kiss. Now, I don't know about you, but in COVID, I do not want to greet 3,000 people, let alone 140, with a holy kiss. But you know what? When COVID hit, like many of you, I kind of closed my circle down of the people that I would be face-to-face with without a mask on, right? And I'd shake their hands, and I'd give them hugs, but not everybody else. And so in the same way, you can't really greet one another. We're not expecting you to come walking out of the parking lot kissing everybody you see. But I bet there's a group of people you give a hug to every Sunday morning, isn't there? We're talking again about the church having to become for you somewhat smaller, a group that you commit with. Romans 15:7, accept one another then just as Christ has accepted you. Yeah, I can say, yeah, I'll accept everybody. You can do whatever you want, I'll do what I want. But this is talking about a real acceptance. When I get to know you and your foibles and you know mine, I see you warts and all and I still say, yeah, you're one of mine. You know, we're people together, brother and sister. Serve one another. Galatians 5:13, you, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. Again, happens best in relationship. Romans 12:10, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. How can you be devoted to 140 people? I mean devoted, where you put their interests above your own. It happens in a smaller group. 1 Thessalonians 5:11, therefore encourage one another, build each other up just as in fact you were doing. Colossians 3, bear with one another and forgive one another. How do you forgive somebody unless you've been in a relationship and you have something to forgive them for? Do you realize that it's our relationships, our smaller groupings, where we're supposed to practice being like Jesus, where we have people who offend us? Anybody have anybody offend you this week? Anybody have anything that you had to forgive somebody or should have forgiven somebody? Boy, you're living good lives then. I got a few, and I can tell you there's some people who need to forgive me because I'm in relationship with people, and we're in a broken world. And yet, instead of saying, gosh, when you offend me, pff, you're out of my life. No, this is where we get to practice in relationship, doing what Jesus did, saying, hey, you owe me a debt, but I forgive you because I've been forgiven. Bear one another's burdens, Galatians 6 says. Teach one another, Romans 15 says. Ephesians 5 says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. All of this takes place in smaller groups, which is why I'm encouraging you to say, to realize you're not going to grow spiritually. Not even if you seek God daily, give weekly, if you don't somehow find a smaller group of people that you commit to, that you do life with. In fact, let me give you a few reasons. I'm going to close with this. Five reasons why God wants you to team up with other believers. I've left you some blanks there if you want to fill these in. Number one, we were created for fellowship. Go all the way back to Genesis 2. Do you like my joke, incidentally, Genesis 2 joke, you know? When did God create Adam? A little before Eve. I like that, huh? What's the picture there? Why did God create Adam? What's God say? He looked at all that he had made and said it was very good. That's the end of the creation story. But then Genesis 2, he looks at Adam and he says, it is not good for the man, what? To be alone. Ask any senior citizen who's found themselves alone. The kids are gone. Maybe won't even call today dad for Father's Day. The spouse they spent 40 years with is not there. The neighbors drive in the garage and put down the door. And they'll tell you they're not made to be alone. There's no reason for anybody in a church to ever feel that. We're made for community. Number one, why does God want us to team up with other believers? We're created for fellowship. Number two, we need accountability. We need other people who can call us on our stuff. Do you have anybody in your life that will call you on your stuff? Anybody who, if you're not married, let me ask you that, because sometimes our spouses are really good at calling us on our stuff, aren't they? But is there anybody else who can speak into your life and say, you know what, I think you're missing something here. I think you're trusting in the wrong thing. I think you're putting your resources where they shouldn't. If you didn't, then you never got to play the childhood game. Remember this childhood game? Uh-huh. It was really funny, right, to put that on somebody's seat and they'd walk around all day getting kicked and they weren't sure what happened. They needed somebody who was a mirror to them and say, I can see things in you and about you you can't see about yourself. And so part of the reason God's created us for fellowship is we desperately need people who have the courage and the care to call us out, to hold us accountable. Number three, others need my gifts and service. That comes from that 1 Corinthians passage. It actually says up in verse 7 that all the gifts that the Spirit gives, all the kinds of ministry, all kinds of the works, they all come from the same Spirit, but the Spirit of God determines who gets what, and he gives all those gifts, it says, for the common good. So he didn't make me good with words for my sake, so I can write novels and get rich. He made me good with words so I could speak for 20 minutes and most of the time keep you awake, right? It's for the common good. And the same is true of you. God created you for community, created, and you need accountability, but others need your gifts. They need your service. And if you're not committed to a smaller group of people, guess what? You're stealing from the people that God gave you a gift to embed. Number four, Christ is present in community. Remember, Jesus says, wherever two or more are gathered in my name, what? There am I, right? I'm there. Somehow in a different way than when I'm all by myself, when it's you and me as Christ's followers, Jesus says, I am present there. That means there's a power there. There's a wisdom there. There's a love there. There's a care there that Jesus is actually present. And so we need community, fellowship for Christ to be present. And then finally, I would say community is a witness to the world. Jesus prays this prayer in John 17. It's the longest prayer that's recorded in Scripture of him praying. It's right before he's going to be crucified. He's with his disciples in the upper room. And he says, Father, my prayer for all of them is that they will be of one heart and mind so the world will believe you sent me. It's when others who aren't Christ followers see the way Christ followers take care of each other, the way we grow together, the way we hold one another accountable, the way we use our gifts to embed others. They look at that and they say, wow, that is not a picture of our world, but that's a world I want. And so our togetherness, our fellowship is a witness to God's world. Well, you've done a good job taking notes. I've got one other line, and this is the summation of the sermon. I would say the church must grow larger and smaller at the same time. We struggle with this at Central College. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. I see some who I know would raise your hands. But we don't have as many of us in smaller groups as we really ought. And that means we're missing out on these five purposes in a way that we shouldn't. And so I'm asking you to consider taking out that commitment card that you got this morning. Can you pull that out, my maturity covenant? And right at the top it says, I'm already a partner of the church. I'm a member. If you're a member, you can check that. If you're not, that's a first step. See if I got my card here somewhere. I think I do. Yeah, it looks like this, my spiritual maturity covenant. So at the top, I'm a partner, member for Christ with God's people through Central College. If that's you, that's great, and that's this first step here of belonging. And if you're not, then would you consider committing to be a partner for Christ with God's people through Central College? If you check that box, that means you'll get a call from one of the pastors. We'll sit down with you and talk to you about partnership, and then you'll meet with the elders at a Zoom meeting, and you'll be a part of the partnership. But now let's move from belonging to growing. And what I'm giving you the opportunity today to do is to commit to these habits. It doesn't mean tomorrow you're going to automatically, tomorrow and every day after, spend daily time with God. You'll probably miss some days. It doesn't mean tomorrow that you're going to have to write your tithe out. It doesn't mean tomorrow that you've got to find that small group of people. But it's saying, no, I believe that these are habits that I need to grow, and I will commit to work on building them into my life. May take some time, but I'm making the commitment now to grow, Pastor. My encouragement is that you sign that you put a date on it, and that you join with what I know are going to be many, many dozens of others who say, hey, we're glad to belong and be partners, but we want to go the next step now. It's simply a way of saying, I want to become like Jesus, and so I'm going to eat the bread, get the rest, breathe the breath. That's the physical habits. I'm going to seek God daily. I'm going to give weekly or regularly. And I'm going to commit regularly to a smaller team of people so that I can grow. If you make that commitment, how do you fulfill it, that last one? Well, let me give you three ways. Way number one is call Nate Rector, call one of the pastors, or go on the church website and say, I'd like to connect with one of our life groups. Some of them are Sunday school classes. Some of them are groups that have been meeting for 30 or 40 years. They don't call themselves life groups, but they function that way. They're smaller groups of people who meet sometimes once a week, sometimes twice a month, sometimes once a month, but they meet together to be in the Word, to share their lives, to hold each other accountable, to support each other and serve each other. You can be a part of one of those. A second way is to join a ministry. You hear opportunities all the time. We say we need a Sunday school teacher, or we need vacation Bible school workers, or we need help for the Freedom Celebration. If you get involved with one of those things, you're going to find there's another group of people, there's going to be a group of people who've committed to the same thing. That's another way. So either a life group, a ministry, or the third way is available to everybody here. And that is turn to the person behind you in the pew and say, hey, you want to do life together? Do you want to just call each other on a regular basis? Do you want to maybe get in the Word together? Would you pray for me and allow me to pray for you? Doesn't have to be something formal, but you got to get outside your own skin and connect with somebody. You could do that this morning before you leave this place. So my encouragement is, let's not just belong together. Let's grow together. Let's make a larger church smaller at the same time. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's stand together and sing together about this unity about the tie that binds us.
Mind.
God has blessed us with amazing grace, and all that we have comes from Him. So now we are given this opportunity to return but a portion of that amazing grace with the giving of His tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, You have called our church to the mission of making Your kingdom visible in all that we are about in worship and service. So now we dedicate these gifts to that purpose. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Lord God, it is on eagle's wings that You gather us and we fly with You. Thank You for Your Holy Spirit, which lives and moves among us and guides us in all that we are about. O God of love, we give You thanks, for we richly enjoy health and vigor and love and care. Care for our families within our own homes. We ask for blessings to be with fathers, with dads this day, who give us happiness and strength. We praise You, Lord, for being our Father, who isn't in heaven, yet right here in our very midst, as Your Holy Spirit leads and guides us in our ways of living together through discipleship, fellowship, worship, service, and evangelism. To that end, we pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, who taught His disciples and those of us who have chosen to follow Him, that when we pray, we say these words together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Signed one of those covenants, you can just drop it in the I guess you can hand it to an usher on the way out. If you didn't put it in the offering plate, that'd be great, or put it on one of those stools. We'd love to know that you've made that covenant commitment. Remember, we have a congregational meeting, so we're going to make our way down to Kirk Hall. They may just be finishing worship. We can kind of slide quietly in the back, and we'll be about 15 minutes there. Now may the grace of God attend you, may the love of Christ fill you, and may God's own Spirit keep you, that you might live in faith, abound in hope, and grow in love today and forevermore. Amen.
God bless you, brother.
And you too.